Hey, grab something to take notes with, and let's just take a minute and welcome our correctional facility campus. Tell all those guys we love them. ERDCC, love you guys. Hear amazing things of what God's doing there. Today we are going back in this series on the role of the Holy Spirit in the life of a follower of Christ. And anytime you get on the topic of the Holy Spirit, more than really any other you end up kind of seeing the backgrounds that people come from, because in Christendom, everybody kind of comes from a different place when it comes to the role of the Holy Spirit. How many of you come from a Catholic background? Most of this service, right? And then how many of you come from a Baptist background? You're not comfortable even raising your hand, are you? How many from a charismatic background? Yeah, like you guys raised both hands. And then how many from a heathen background? Like just heathen, yeah, right. Your background informs a lot of what you know or don't know about the role of the Holy Spirit. And so let me just say, regardless of your background, it's the most important relationship in your life. Because the Holy Spirit is God's agent of activity. Anything God's going to do is going to be through the Holy Spirit in your life. So growing in that relationship is essential, but that's not easy because he's invisible, intangible, immaterial. And so to kind of grasp his nature, which is not easy to grasp, Scripture does something interesting. Though he's a person, and I can't emphasize that enough, he's a person, we get pictures of the way he operates through really material concepts in Scripture. There's almost symbols. And so in this series, we've just kind of been going symbol by symbol to kind of help you grasp a little bit more about his nature. Today, I want to talk to you about how the Holy Spirit is pictured in Scripture as oil, okay? A few months ago, Kayla and I took a couple of days to go and spend with our two oldest girls. We're in this phase where we're trying to spend individual time with the kids. And so we went to this hotel that had a large convention center. And at the exact same time that we were there, there was a large convention for lawyers. There were just lawyers everywhere. And I was kind of feeling mischievous at breakfast one morning. And I told the girls, we explained what the convention was. And I just told them, I said, I'm here because I'm going to stop pastoring Twin Rivers and I'm going to become a lawyer. And you're like, why do you lie to your kids? It's like, well, because it's fun, you know, and that's why. And immediately, we didn't expect it, like Sydney tears up and Ellie's angry. And Ellie, she says, you can't, no, this can't happen. Lawyers are awful. And which I don't know where she, if you're a lawyer, apparently Ellie, she doesn't have anything for you. But, and she said, you're called to be a pastor. And it was kind of such an emotional response that I quickly said, I'm kidding. And I told him. So I asked him, I said, why does that bother you so much? And Sydney says, she goes, because if you're not a pastor, we can't get gifts on pastor's appreciation. So you're spoiling my kids. Thank you for that. But here's what it reminded me of. My kids know what I'm called to do. Okay. My question is, do you know what you're called to do? Okay. One of the most interesting pictures in Scripture of the Holy Spirit is oil. And it's a special blend given by God, a recipe given by God in the Old Testament. And it was used to anoint or set apart an individual for an assignment God had given them. So kings were anointed with oil. Priests were anointed with oil. Prophets were anointed with oil. It was a visible reminder to the person and those who saw this take place that this person is under assignment. They have been set apart for something God wants them to do. And in the New Testament, it really gets broad because here's what 1 John 2:20 says, but you have an anointing from the Holy One. You have been set apart, specially gifted, and prepared by the Holy Spirit. I know anointing is not a word that we really use a lot in our culture, but if you wanted a very simple definition, the anointing of the Holy Spirit is on your life. It's when he puts his super on your natural. It's when he puts his divinity on your humanity, and it's for his purposes. And according to this, every single one of you have an anointing. And that means, first of all, you're called. Now, let me just say, the biggest lie that is perpetuated the most people, or that is perpetuated in most people's lives to keep them from ministry is this, that most people believe you have to be in vocational ministry to be used by God. You have to do what I do. And it's a lie, because here's the irony of Scripture. Almost everyone in Scripture did what you do, not what I do. Okay, let's just real quick. In the Old Testament, Abraham was in livestock, not preaching. And he was very wealthy, Scripture says. In the Old Testament, Joshua was in the military. In the Old Testament, we find that Daniel worked in government. In the Old Testament, Nehemiah was in the service industry. He was a king's cupbearer. He just was like in a catering company. In the New Testament, Luke is a physician. Paul was a tent maker. James and John ran a fishing business, and they had employees and boats, and it was kind of this enterprise. Matthew was an IRS agent, which shows God can use just anybody, right? All I'm saying, this is the irony of this lie that, you know, you're just here for me to exercise my calling. That's crazy. Because in Scripture, more people do what you do than what I do. And the same thing's true now. You have an anointing. Some of you are anointed to care. Some of you are anointed to teach. Some of you are anointed to govern. Some of you are anointed to make money. Some of you are anointed to write. Some of you are anointed to cook. Some of you are anointed to host. Some of you are anointed to help. Some of you are anointed to build. As diverse as you are, so are the diversity of your anointings. But every single one of you is anointed. And here's something else you need to know. Everything about your life contributes to that anointing. In the Old Testament, Exodus chapter 30, you can read the recipe God gave for the anointing. It's a recipe. Like, it's multiple parts blended together to make this anointing oil. Well, the same thing's true of your life. God takes all of your life, and like a recipe, he blends it together for your anointing. For example, your history is part of your anointing. Where you were born, who you were born to, the experiences you've had, all that's part of your anointing. Your heart is part of your anointing. Like, your motivations, there's a reason you're passionate about some things and not others. Why you have interest in some things and not others. It's part of your anointing. Even this, your hurts are part of your anointing. Now, I know that for many of you, you think, no, that's the thing that disqualifies me. Listen, this is the craziest thing. In Exodus 30, when you read the items that are in the anointing oil, the very first one listed is myrrh. Myrrh, there was twice as much myrrh as any other item. And myrrh, guess what it means? Bitter. So in God's concoction, there's twice as much bitterness as anything else. It's his way of saying the most painful parts of your life will be the most potent part of your anointing. It's the idea that God can definitely mix in a divorce. 100% he can mix in abuse. Absolutely. The things that were done to you, the bad decisions, addictions, 100% they're going to make it into your anointing. And God, if you give it to the Lord, here's what's amazing. He'll take the greatest miseries of your life and somehow he'll bring ministry out of it. It's the craziest thing. And you want that to happen, because here's one of the things that I think we miss sometimes. We think that God only relieves pain, but that's not what he does. He also redeems pain. And as a matter of fact, I would go as far as to say this, you're not healed until God's used your pain to heal someone else. It's just part of your anointing. Now, you have an anointing. That's biblically substantiated. The problem is this, very few people are aware of the anointing they have. I thought about this week. If I was your spiritual enemy, I would not waste all my time trying to get you not to believe in Jesus. And here's why. There's just too much. There's just too much evidence. There's just too much. I mean, historically, thematically, prophetically, there's just too much evidence. It would be a losing battle. So if I was your spiritual enemy, I wouldn't spend all my time trying to discredit Jesus. I would just spend all my time trying to keep you distracted or from discovering his anointing for your life. Like, let me say it this way. Like, I'd be fine with you going to church. I just wouldn't want you to become the church and make a difference. And so what I would do is I'd just fill your life with stuff and lies that made you think, yeah, Jesus is who he is, but you never discover who you are. That's what I would do. And apparently that's what he's doing, because statistically 87% of people never discover their own spiritual gifts, and 90% of people never lead another person to Christ. A few years ago, I got it was my birthday, and my mom and dad bought me one of these armbands that kind of measures health habits, which, just let me say, that's an odd birthday gift. On one end, you appreciate the thought, and on the other end, you're concerned, like, why do my gifts now surround weight loss, right? I mean, it's just, so anyways, in the midst of all the kind of the party, I thanked them, and I set it to the side. And I didn't come back to it, like, for it's just something that was sitting there. I didn't get to it. I appreciated the gift. I just didn't start wearing it immediately. So therefore, a few weeks went by and I didn't use it. And one day I walk in the kitchen and Kayla reaches for something, and I see on her arm this band. And I said, "What are you doing? Where did you get that?" And she goes, "Oh, it's yours." And I said, "I know. I noticed it's on your arm." And she said, "Well, you're not using it." And so, you know, the Dobbins household is cutthroat, okay? But let me just say, her response is biblical. It's biblical because God's given you an anointing. And just because you don't want to open it up, and just because you don't want to discover how it should be used in your life, doesn't mean the work of God's Spirit's going to be stalled. As much as God wants to do things through you, he's fine with going and doing them through somebody else. You have an anointing, but you have to take time to discover it, explore it, search it, use it. You have to open it up and actually begin to use it in your life. And here's my biggest concern for you as your pastor. My biggest concern is not that you won't make it to heaven. It's that your life will not make difference on earth. That's my biggest concern. My biggest concern is you will live for a lesser life. You will become distracted with things that aren't eternal, that you will give yourself to things that will not last even 5 years from now, and you'll spend your whole life and your anointing will go unexplored. You have an anointing. And that means you should at some point accept it, become aware of it, explore it, and hopefully begin to operate in it, because you'd be amazed at what God can do through you. Okay, now here's what I feel like I've been on a journey, you know, my entire life to discover what God has for me. And so I was trying to think, if I were to coach you, not like if I were to just say, what makes a good sermon outline, but if I were to coach you on how to discover God's anointing for your life, and let me just say, not even discover, to activate God's anointing on your life. How do you turn this thing on? So that's the way I wrote these 4 points today. Somebody asked me, they said, "We got 3 points today." I said, "No, we got four. It's a bonus round today." Okay, so let me give you this is like, just if I were to coach you how to activate your anointing, this is what I would tell you. First and foremost, passionately pursue Jesus. Okay, now you may think that's odd, because you would say, "Well, I thought we're talking about me and my anointing." Okay, your anointing is part of God's purpose. Do you know what God's purpose, what really helps with God's purpose? God. He's a central part of his purpose. And so what I'm basically saying to you is that our search or our discovery of our anointing never takes us away from God. It's not some mystic journey with which we find ourselves. It's where we find him. And so let me just say, outside of a growing relationship with Christ, you don't find your anointing. You find it the closer you get to him. And I'm going to show it to you in Scripture. When Jesus called the 12 disciples, he was specific about this. Let me show it to you. Mark 3:13. And he went up, this is Jesus, on the mountain and called to him those he himself wanted. And they came to him. Now look at verse 14. Then he appointed 12 that they may be with him, and that he might send them out to preach and have power to heal sickness and cast out demons. Jesus didn't just call the disciples to do for him. He called them to be with him. And out of their being, they do with him, do for him. And this is the problem with most people's anointing. They get it backwards. They get into the do for him, and they forget it's about being with him. God wants to be with you. So much that he created you. And then, even despite the fact that we went into sin, he then redeemed us through the death of his son. He created heaven so that we could spend all eternity with him. But we don't have to wait to eternity. We can be with him now. Every day, in a moment, he is with us. And if you read out what the Holy Spirit, he's literally, the Holy Spirit's in you because God wants to be with you. And so we're with him, and then we do for him. Let me explain it this way. An extension cord is very helpful. But an extension cord is not a source of power. It is nothing more than a transit for power. Like I take an extension cord and plug it into a refrigerator, but if it's not plugged in the wall, it doesn't matter if it's plugged in the refrigerator. If it's fully kind of unrolled, it makes no difference. The only thing that makes that extension cord useful is when it is plugged into the source. And when you and I try to fulfill our calling without being connected to the Lord, we're just powerless. It's ineffective. It doesn't make any difference. But if we spend time with him, we channel the same power that the Lord Jesus channeled, that he operated in. When you spend time with the Lord, all of a sudden the character of Jesus shows up in your life. You start to act and react in your marriage, your parenting, your job, just like Jesus would. All of a sudden, the competence of Jesus shows up. I mean, Jesus just makes you smarter than you actually are because he knows all, so therefore he'll give you wisdom and understanding to things that you walk in and you used to see problems, now you see solutions because you're channeling the competence of Jesus. When you also do it, it's just the compassion of Jesus. This is one I especially, if I don't spend time with the Lord, I just don't have compassion for people because I, in and of myself, I don't have compassion for me. But when I spend time with the Lord, my heart breaks for people. My heart has mercy towards people. My reactions, because I'm not because of me, I'm channeling, I'm plugged into the source. Even the courage of Jesus. Notice he said, I'm going to allow demons to cast out demons. Means hell's going to come against your calling, but it's not going to be a problem as long as you're with Christ. That you'll overcome. Do you know why your soul's so tired all the time? Because you're trying to operate without the anointing. You're trying to kind of fulfill your purpose and your strength. Our daily connection to God is what regulates how much power from God we receive and relay to anyone else. And so goes the being, so goes the doing. So the first thing is we just consistently, passionately pursue him if we want to activate our anointing. Here's the second one, discover your spiritual gifts. Now, when you were born physically, you had some natural talents. When you're born again spiritually, you receive spiritual gifts. These are supernatural abilities, receptors to receive and then distribute a work of the Holy Spirit in someone's life. And if you read the New Testament, you can find nearly 25 spiritual gifts. I believe that's just the beginning. That's not the only spiritual gifts. They're just the beginning. They're in several passages. Like, for example, in Romans chapter 12, there are 7 spiritual gifts. And they're listed. They're like leadership, encouragement. Like some of you are just, you see what no one else sees. You see when someone's countenance is down. You see when someone's discouraged. Like you're very attuned to other people. God didn't just show you that. That's a spiritual gift beginning. And what you're supposed to do is write an email, send a text, give a word of encouragement. And listen, sometimes we act like encouragement's just being nice. Encouragement is taking courage from the Holy Spirit and installing it in someone else. Because the number one thing people deal with is what? Fear. I wouldn't be here if some people didn't encourage me with the spiritual gift. Also in that list includes things like helps. There are some people who are supercharged to help. It means they just sense the anointing when they're stacking chairs, cleaning up something, laying things out. They don't want to be seen. They would never want to do what I'm doing right now. But when they are left to themselves to complete tasks, they can sense the anointing on their life. A task that would drain you, it energizes them because they're anointed for it. Giving, we're all called to be live a generous life. No one's not supposed to be generous if you're a follower of Christ, but there are some people who have been given the gift of giving. The gift of giving, here's what I like to think. It means you're a kingdom investor. God's probably going to give you more, and it's because you have this mindset that walks in and goes, that's something God wants to do, and you're going to resource what God wants to do. Like our campuses are propelled forward by people with the gift of giving who walk in and go, Pastor Joe, you set the direction, but we're going to be the accelerator to push this thing forward with supernatural. They're just, that's what they're gifted to do. Okay, well then you swing over to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, you'll find there's another list of spiritual gifts. Now these though are a little bit more unusual and they're the ones that get a lot of attention. They include things like tongues, words of wisdom, healing, And this is really interesting. One of them's called a word of knowledge. So let me tell you what a word of knowledge is. It's when you have supernatural knowledge you couldn't have learned without the Holy Spirit revealing it to you. A couple of First Wednesdays ago, the Holy Spirit gave me a word of knowledge, and in a room like this, I said, there's a lady here who you have diagnosed digestive issues. They don't know why you have digestive issues, but it's because you stay consistently stressed, bound up because of your children and what's going on in their lives. And all of a sudden, there's this lady, I think she was in this back corner. She raised her hand and says, that's me. And she responded in faith, and completely that was relieved in her life. Now, how would I know that? Except for by gift of the Holy Spirit, okay? Well, the same thing. Miracles are the same way. You know, miracles are in that list, and you could be a part of a miracle just by praying for something or asking God to do something. A lot of times, we just don't think miracles happen that much, and it's because we're just not aware. Like, for example, consider divine protection. Like you don't get to see what would have happened had that miracle not taken place. Like, they're, you know, in heaven, they're handing out assignments, and your angel, like, they say, hey, we want you today to protect them in driving. And they're like, Lord, have you seen the way they text and drive? I mean, you don't know how many times that angel steered you and brought you back and all that. These are miracles. Now, here's what I want you to know. These gifts are not harder for the Holy Spirit than any other gift. Like, he doesn't have to pull out of China and only come to St. Louis to do a miracle. And they're not harder for believers either. Notice I said believers. People who see consistent spiritual gifts displayed in their life just expect it. And here's what they know. Oil flows. And here's what I mean. They just know all they have to do is be a vessel and the oil will flow. They're just open and ready and available. As long as they're willing, it'll just flow. And here's why. We don't possess these gifts. And this is a misunderstanding we need to make sure to grasp. 1 Corinthians 12:11. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually just as he wills. Why is this verse so important? Because most people believe that gifts are possessed by people. They think that TV personalities and preachers and, you know, all these big names and faces, those are the ones who have gifts. No man possesses the gifts of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit possesses the gifts of the Spirit, and he distributes them to anyone at any time they are needed. One of my favorite examples of this, Dr. Lamar Vest is, you may not know his name, but he is one of the most esteemed kingdom leaders of the last 75 years in America. He was president of the American Bible Society, president of a university, president of a denomination. I mean, everywhere you go, his name among leaders is esteemed. He told me one time that he had been traveling from conference to conference worldwide. I mean, conferences filled with some of the greatest men of God, women of God. And he said, I had developed a sinus infection and an abscess. And he said, it was awful. And he said, I was in Korea and asked them to pray for me. And nothing. And he said, it didn't change. And I was in, you know, this place and asked them to pray for me in Brazil. And he said, I'd went around the world just on this travel. And everywhere I went, I asked people to pray. And it just, nothing. He said, I came home and I was sitting in my chair and my head was hurting so bad. And he said, his daughter came in the room. She's about 8 years old. And she saw him holding his head. And she said, Dad, what's wrong? And he said, I've just got this awful for weeks. I've had this. And she just walks up to him, puts her hand on his shoulder, says, Jesus, heal my daddy. And she runs off and plays. He said, immediately, he was healed. Immediately. He had been around the greatest ministers the world had to offer, but the Holy Spirit distributed it through an 8-year-old girl in that moment. Anyone can give a word of wisdom. Anyone can pray for someone to be healed. Anyone can operate in a miracle because it's the Holy Spirit who does it. You just have to be willing to go with his flow. Okay? Here's the next one. You have to look for opportunities today. Now, here's the thing about oil. It's not created to store. It's created to be poured. And so is your anointing. God's not giving you this anointing to stick it in a jar. But most of us, when it comes to kind of helping others, doing ministry, doing our calling, here's what, we put it on delay. Because in our minds, we're not ready yet. You know, we need to get things in order. We need to, you know, many of you have thought, well, I need to get my act together before God can have me do something. Some of you think, I need to learn more. Before, some of you have thought, well, I'm just in a place where we're super busy and I'm going to get to that eventually. Listen to me. Your calling's not eventually. It's every day. I think more than anything else that that disables the body of Christ, it's thinking that what God wants them to do is somewhere in the future. It's today. God didn't give you an anointing for somewhere down the road. It's now. Let me show it to you. 2 Corinthians 2:6. As God partners, we beg you not to accept this marvelous gift of God's kindness and then ignore it. For God says, at just the right time I heard you, and on the day of salvation I helped you. Indeed, the right time is, help me with this word, now. Today is the day of salvation. Today. One day Sydney comes in the room. I think she's about 4 years old. I was working, and she came in and said, Dad, she goes, let's wrestle. And I mean, she's blonde hair, blue eyes, and Hulk Hogan on the inside, you know. And I said, okay, in 10 minutes. And so, you know, 4 years old, 10 minutes might as well be eternity. And she waited and waited and waited. She's, Dad, let's wrestle. I said, just a minute. She goes, Dad, if I wait any longer, I'm going to be a grandma, and grandmas can't wrestle. Okay. Listen. There's patience is a fruit of the Spirit, unless it has to do with your anointing. You can be impatient with your anointing, because when you woke up this morning, so did it. Your calling got up with you this morning for today. And your calling's not down the road. It's not years from now. It's not so once you make that happen or this. It's today. Someone needs encouraged today. We need a life group leader today. We need people to get ready to go to the camp today. We need, a soccer team needs to be coached by a godly leader today. Someone needs to run for the school board today. Like there's an anointing on your life, and it's today. It's not in the future. And what I'm concerned that you're going to miss is this. If you always think your anointing is in the future, you miss the reality that your anointing today is what's preparing you for the anointing in the future. This ain't my first ministry position. You know what my first one was? Lock the building up. Like, stay till everybody's left and lock the building up. Which y'all stay forever. Like, I'm trying to get to lunch and you gotta say your three more things and no, I'm saying. And here's what I'm very aware of. Had I not volunteered to lock the building up, I wouldn't have been the pastor, because it's all part, the anointing, it grows. It's blending. It's coming more. And when you skip today's anointing, you miss the future anointing. Or if you get to it, you're not prepared for it. Okay? Your anointing's not in a title. It's in today. Your anointing is not in a position. It's in today. Your anointing's not for one day and when everything. No. It's today. And all it requires is for you to start looking for it today. Okay, now here's the last one. When you see it, move despite being scared. Here's the hard truth. Every believer has the person of the Holy Spirit living in them. But not every believer experiences the power of the Holy Spirit in their living. Why does God seem to work through other people more than other people? God does more through those who risk more. That's really what it is. It's not his desire. It's not his favoritism. It's just some people move despite being scared. And some people stay because they're scared. I wish I could tell you along the way that it just, there's a point where it gets comfortable following the move of God. It just never does. Here's what's going to happen. Every time you sense God wanting to anoint you for a moment to say something, do something, fear is there to counsel you. And fear is going to tell you you don't have time and you don't have the expertise and you don't have the ability and you're not needed. And here's what people who do great things for God do. It's not that they're not scared. It's that they move despite being scared. They just decide, you know what? I hear your fear. I hear, despite fear of lack, despite fear of inadequacy, despite fear of failure. Because here's what people who risk a lot for God have figured out. Even in my failures, God can do something. One of my favorite stories, there was this gentleman who, him and his wife moved to South Africa as missionaries to plant churches, and they had planted a lot of churches over a 40-year career. And eventually, though, they got older, retired, came back to the United States, lived here for about 10 years, and she passed away. Well, she was passed away, and you know, he was 90, but the fire was still in him. So one day he gets up at his local church and he announces to the pastor and everyone there, I'm going back to South Africa to plant more churches. And, you know, people thought, oh, that's nice. Well, turns out he was serious. The next Sunday he shows up, he's bought the tickets, and he announces to the church, he said, I want you to pray for me. I feel like there's still 50 churches in me. He's 90 years old. So they pray for him, give him a little bit of money, and he goes out the door. Well, he gets back to South Africa, and about 2 weeks later he dies. And back home, everybody said, well, he just, you know, his zeal outmatched, you know, and that was, he had a good heart, but he just didn't understand God's real will. Well, they did a funeral for him in South Africa, and thousands of people came because he'd spent 30 years there. And at the funeral, the person preaching his funeral just felt the Holy Spirit just quicken him to the idea that there wasn't just going to be a prayer to dismiss, but today, how many of you are called to plant a church because of the way this man lived his life? Well, all of a sudden, people start standing. Before it's all said and done, 100 people commit to plant the church. Turned out the guy was wrong. He didn't have 50 in him. He had 100 in him. You have no idea what God's put in you. No idea. And if I was coaching you, here's what I would say. This role, I'm just telling you, I remember having those arguments with God. I said, God, I can't do this. And he said, oh, it's okay, I can. God, I'm telling you, I'm not strong enough. I don't know enough. And God says, okay, I know everything and I'm strong enough. Good. Okay. Okay, God, but I'm completely inadequate. No education to do this. No history in this. I didn't go to school to be a pastor. I am no family that's ever done this. Okay. I'm adequate. I'm sufficient. And at some point, here's what you're going to have happen as you kind of just go back and forth with God. He's already taken into consideration all of your excuses, and he has an answer for each one of them, and so he's going to leave you with this choice. You're either going to continue to look at what you're not, or you're going to take a risk in light of what he is. That's it. You don't ever get to a place where you feel you're adequate. As a matter of fact, the adequacy and the anointing never work together. Never. The anointing comes on inadequacy. So listen, you almost learn to just embrace inadequacy. Man, I don't feel like I can do this, but the anointing is going to be here. Man, I don't feel like I know enough, but I can expect the anointing to show up. And that's what we find. Now, listen, this is why you care about this message. Your calling is your key to contentment. Okay. Most people are going to live their lives getting education. They're going to get, opportunity. They're going to build a career. They're going to build a family. They're going to have some experiences. And they're going to come to the end of their life and still not feel content. Listen, nothing wrong with all that. It's just not what will complete you. They come to the end and they still don't feel content. And here's the problem. They weren't made for all of that. They were given an anointing. And until they use that anointing, they will not feel the contentment their heart desires. I'm just telling you, people who really go after their calling, they don't struggle with comparison like other people do because they realize they have a calling and someone else has a calling. They don't struggle with getting distracted the way other people do. They're not shaken by circumstance the way other people do. They're not worried about their past. They're not kind of messed up in the present. They're excited about the future because here's where they're at. They see that God has called them to make an impact and that their response is a display of worship to their God and that they get to be a part of what he is doing. And there's just a richness, a satisfaction. There's just something that no experience or no amount of achievement or accomplishment or a title, it just never will do. There's just a richness in knowing that he doesn't have to, but God has chosen to anoint me and use me for his purposes. So you have an anointing. I want you to stand to your feet. I'm going to invite our prayer team to come real quick to the front. Real quick. So I called the team yesterday. It was very late. And I said, hey, I know we've been doing these messages with kind of this open prayer. But today I really felt like the Holy Spirit just stirred my heart to something different. So what we've done is every one of these prayer team members has oil. Just oil that we would use. It's biblically, you know, again, James 5:16 tells us to anoint people. So here's what I'm going to do. Today you just want a fresh anointing. You want to walk this out. You want to see that activated. I'm going to give you a step of faith. I'm going to pray for you. When I say amen, you can step out, and they're going to just anoint every person that comes forward today. And it's not going to be long. It's not some drawn-out thing. They're just anointing you, and it's just a step of faith. It's a visible reminder that the Holy Spirit has given you an anointing, and you're going to call. And here's what I think is going to happen. Because of your faith, this week, the Holy Spirit's going to highlight someone to you. Maybe probably today, something, a gifting is going to start leaning. Maybe you're going to feel the priority to go to Connect Track, learn your spiritual gifts. And you're just going to start getting this thing on track that like, okay, I'm doing life, but I'm anointed. The Holy Spirit wants to use my life. So I'm going to pray. And as soon as I say amen, if you just want a fresh a touch of an anointing, God, I'm responding today because I want you to operate in my life, Holy Spirit. I want you to step out. I want you to come forward. They're going to do it in a real orderly, easy fashion, and they're going to sing. So let me pray for you. I want you to think of this prayer as kind of a commissioning. That's what it is. It's kind of a commissioning. Okay. Father, thank you today for every single gift, every single anointing, every single diverse experience and history and hurt, God, and just in a beautiful way, you are blending it all together for your purposes. And so, Lord, for those who are lacking fulfillment, may today that begin to be fulfilled. For those who are aimless without a calling, may today, Holy Spirit, they sense a divine calling. The same way when I was a teenager standing in an arena, I sensed the marking of the Holy Spirit. May today they sense the marking. They don't get all the answers, but the marking of the Holy Spirit, that every time they move and breathe and operate, they would know, I'm called, I'm called, I'm called. And so, Lord, we just believe that every one of them are needed for your purpose. Everyone have been called according to your purpose, that they have been fashioned in a way, God, that you want to use their life for substantial, significant, eternal things. And so, Lord, I just pray that as they move in faith, that you begin to operate in their life, that gifts would flow through them, that they would... They would just, despite fear, God, that they would just sense a boldness that comes from the filling of the Holy Spirit, and that, God, many, many, many stories will be told because of the step of faith they tell. They're going to tell stories of praying for someone at the job and healing or a miracle or a word of wisdom or knowledge or a supernatural fulfillment through finally learning that they have a gift of giving or helps or hospitality. God, just many stories are going to be told because of a small step of obedience, and you begin to flow in their life. So today, we, by the authority you've given me as their pastor, I commission them and send them in the same way that you anointed and sent your disciples to fulfill their calling and operate in their anointing. In Jesus' name, and everybody says, amen.